So, welcome to our seventh session in the Worlds of Speculative Fiction series. This one we're focusing on Roger Zelazny, the Chronicles of Amber, which are about, you know, this much book. There's five stories in the first sequence in that, and I'm only going to talk about the first sequence. He wrote another five books later on. They're kind of written in an erudite style, but also very readable. So when I was going back through them, I was surprised by how quickly I got through, because I was a little worried about, you know, doing all the reading myself in preparation, but they go very quickly. And so this series is focused on worlds and world-building in classic science fiction and fantasy, and philosophical themes that emerge in that. We've talked about Tolkien, C.S. Lewis, A.E. van Vogt, Asimov. Last month we did Frank Herbert. We had a really great discussion about that. And so this time we're doing another guy. We're sort of moving ahead chronologically a bit. Although this guy is really a contemporary of Herbert. These sessions all have the same general structure. A lot of you have been in these and have been participating before. So I give a few initial remarks about the author. I give you a handout with some biographical context. We talk a little bit about the timeline. And then we jump into some discussion about plot, character, and narrative worlds. And then I've usually got some philosophical themes picked out that I think are, that stand out for these characters or these writers. Sometimes other people have other themes that they want to bring in, and that's great too. And then there's time for general discussion and Q&A afterwards, but the way that we always work these is we can stop at any point for discussion, questions, controversies, you know, clarifications, and we usually have some really great discussion in these. So the initial remarks about Zelazny, before I actually go into them, I'm going to say one sort of biographical thing just about myself. Zelazny was somebody that I encountered in middle school and high school, towards the end of middle school, and I was just completely blown away. I read these, and I read some of his earlier works, and I think if there was any, at one time I had aspirations to be a writer, not an academic writer, but a, you know, a more writerly writer, and he was the guy who I wanted to be, because his style was so beautiful, he was so smart, he seemed like he'd read everything and could weave in allusions about everything. So, and going back to it in my 40s now, sometimes you have the experience, you know, something that when you were an adolescent, you thought it was so great, like maybe an album, and then you listen to it later on, and you're like, oh, that really wasn't very good. I don't know what I was thinking. he really does hold up quite well. So he is really a key figure in a historical development in science fiction called the New Wave of science fiction. So some of the other people that fit in with that would be Frank Herbert, who we talked about last time, Ursula K. Leguin, who we're going to talk about next time, Michael Moorcock, who's somewhere down the line, I don't remember exactly when, Philip Jose Farmer, if you've read any of his stuff, Piers Anthony would also kind of fit into that. And what characterized the New Wave of science fiction is that they were taking a very literary approach to science fiction, meaning that there was this kind of notion that, like, you know, science fiction up until then had been written in a way that was easy to read, and it was very technophilic, we could say, but it didn't incorporate a lot of references to literature. Zelazny was actually a poet, and he'd studied poetry in college, primarily so he could just absorb everything that he could. And he found ways to weave that into the structure of his work. So there was a lot of focus on you know, metaphor and on better dialogue. So there's that whole literary side to it. And then there was also, you know, sometimes we talk about soft and hard sciences. So the hard sciences are like, you know, physics, mathematics to a certain degree, things that are oriented towards technology. And then the soft sciences are the things like sociology or anthropology or psychology. And in science fiction, if we're going to talk about science, right, there was a shift in the New Wave away from just thinking in terms of hard science and in terms of thinking much more in terms of soft science. So Zelazny kind of figures in there. They were also, you know, writing much more. There's other aspects of it. They were writing much more explicit sex scenes, you know, in there. It was part of the what was going on in the 60s, I think, you know, and more generally. Incorporation of themes from myth and legend, you know, sometimes very complex ethical issues. So Zelazny's, you know, right in the midst of that, and he was recognized early on as a very promising writer. I only put, like, the first couple awards that he won in there, because the guy actually won just award after award after award. We'll talk about that in a minute. He also said something really interesting in one of his interviews. He was talking about critics, and he said there's really two kinds of critics. There's, like, editors, you pay attention to them, because they know what they're talking about, and they're only interested in making the novel better or the story better. And he said that when it came to other critics, like people reviewing his works in magazines, he would get criticism that he didn't like, and then he would make sure that the next time he wrote a book or a story, he would incorporate exactly what they didn't like and do more of it. So I kind of like that idea. George R. R. Martin, who we're going to finish up this year with in December, he was very influenced by Zelazny. And he said, this is from his what he said when Zelazny died, that Zelazny died very young, 58 years old, back in 1995. He said, Lord of Light was the first Zelazny book I ever read. I was in college at the time, a longtime reader who dreamed of writing himself one day. I'd never heard of this Zelazny guy. But when I read those words for the first time, a chill went through me, and I sensed that sci-fi would never be the same. Nor was it. Like only a few before him, Roger left his mark on the genre. He left his mark on my life as well. After Lord of Light, I read every word of his I could get my hands on. I knew I'd found one hell of a writer in this fellow with the odd, unforgettable name. I never dreamed that years later I would also find in Roger one hell of a friend. And then he recounts in the rest of the story how he went to Santa Fe, and Zelazny would kind of help him out when he was down, you know, on his luck. As a beginning writer, Zelazny would make him a loan that wasn't actually going to be a loan. You know, all sorts of things along those lines. And if you look at his biography, you know, he starts out, he's a kid in the Midwest. He's born to Joseph and Josephine, kind of an interesting set there. Joseph was Polish, Josephine was Irish, and something else mixed together. And he, you know, he has a fairly, you know, uneventful childhood in comparison to some other kids. He starts reading science fiction fairly young, and, you know, he decides he wants to write. He goes through a couple periods in his life where he realizes his writing isn't really that good, and he takes steps to try to improve it, which is interesting, for me at least, because we often place so much stress on, well, you either have genius or you don't have it, but real writers put in a lot of time mastering their craft. He goes to college, you know. He goes to Western Reserve University, studies English, smart thing to do, I suppose, if you're going to be a writer. And eventually then goes to Columbia, joins the Ohio National Guard, graduates with an MA in English again. He'd studied Elizabethan and Jacobean literature.
Jacobean,
thank you. Always embarrassing when you can't pronounce something right on camera. What are you going to do? He used college essentially. He wasn't like Frank Herbert. Frank Herbert went to college and just took whatever classes he wanted, so he never graduated. He was like, I'm just, you know, this is my smorgasbord, I'm going to do whatever the hell I want, right? So Zelazny was focused, but he knew exactly what he wanted to focus on, and it was writing poetry and studying, you know, how metaphor worked and thinking about how plot worked. And he's, you know, filing all these things in the back of his head. And he's writing, and he's going through sort of successions of this works, this doesn't work. And by the time that he's churning out real finished products, they're really great stuff. A Rose for Ecclesiastes in 1963, it's published. That he's going to be nominated for a Hugo Award for that short story. It's going to get fitted into the book, the doors of his face, the lamps of his mouth. And if you only read one thing by Zelazny, if you haven't read the Chronicles of Amber, that would be a really great place to start, A Rose for Ecclesiastes, because it shows him playing around with things happening on Mars, you know, sort of science fiction-y, but using poetry as a language to communicate with these Martians. You know, you could contrast that with, say, Ray Bradbury, you know, the Martian Chronicles and that sort of business. He gets a day job. Back then, it was pretty easy to get them. He gets a government job with the Social Security Administration, and he's got a plan. He's going to work doing that, and you know, if the writing never works out, then he'll just keep doing that the rest of his life because it pays the bills. But if it does work out, he's going to wait until he passes the threshold where he's making more money as a writer than he is working for the Social Security Administration, and at a certain point, he does pass that. And so he quits the job and becomes a full-time writer. And he said, here's another thing here's a couple things that he actually said. He said, "I decided as a teenager I really didn't know enough to describe character well and I was wasting my time." He'd already started writing stories. "I learned as much as I could about storytelling techniques and it wasn't a matter of technique anymore, it was a matter of substance. As a result, I said I was going to wait until I was a lot older and had more experience. So it was that after I got out of college, I'd been away from sci-fi for about 4 years. I'd read sci-fi steadily from when I was 11 until I started college. When I started college, I said, I'm not going to read that while I'm here. I'm going to learn poetry and other things of that sort. In fact, I wrote a lot of poetry then." So he puts the sci-fi on hold for a while. And then he also did something kind of funny with magazines. And this is pretty smart. He actually was very shrewd when it comes to business. So what I'd do is send my story out to the best paying magazine. And if they didn't want it, I'd just send it out to the second best paying magazine and so on until I'd gone through the entire list. If nobody wanted it, I'd throw it into a box and later on I'd look over it again to see if I could learn anything from it. That was his approach to making money selling stories. And he ends up winning 6 Hugo Awards, 3 Nebula Awards, and then a whole bunch of other, you know, sort of more minor awards, including 2 Balrog Awards. He ends up doing collaborations that I didn't put on this list with other authors, including Philip K. Dick, who we're going to look at later on this year, Fred Saberhagen, Alfred Bester. He's sort of like a dish that can go well with all the other dishes. And these are not easy people to work with, too. I mean, Philip K. Dick was a mess. He actually, Zelazny got brought in to help Dick with a book of his, Dies Irae, which had been stalled. And to call it stalled is kind of a understatement. Dick was just like, you know, what we call these days a hot mess at the time. And Zelazny could work with him. He really was a major influence within science fiction. And that's all, you know, kind of interesting stuff. I'm going to focus more on these works. And again, I'd like to begin with some things that he had to say in interviews about this. So when we're talking about the world and the plot and the characters, there was an interview where he was asked, "You said that the whole first Amber series was planned out in your head and rough. Were you surprised at how big the project turned out?" And he said, "Yes, I thought it was going to be one book, maybe a book and sequel later on. I had no idea how much the story would embellish itself and just keep growing longer. But I'd do other things of that size even bigger." He ends up writing 10 books. So he thinks he's going to start out writing maybe one or two, and it ends up just growing and growing and growing because he's got a good story there. And he did something with these books that's really hard to pull off. Oftentimes, when you see this in TV series a lot, writers will start writing, and what they're writing has got some great dialogue and compelling characters, and there's, you know, there's evil guys and good guys fighting against them, and eventually the evil guys lose, right? And now the question is, well, what do you do? And there's a couple different sort of standard things you can do. Things can break down, and it turns out that some of the good guys are really evil guys all along. Or there's another enemy beyond them who's even bigger. And now what happens is you keep getting larger and larger plots, right? And so pretty soon you're basically fighting the devil, or, you know, fighting some race of beings that are from another galaxy. And after a while, it gets so unbelievable that you can't work with it anymore. And writers kind of lose their sight. And you can look at sci-fi TV series and see this happen over and over and over again. So Zelazny didn't do that with these books. They do get bigger and bigger and bigger. There's wider and wider plots being revealed. But it never gets to the point where you're like, oh, this is just implausible, or this has gotten kind of boring. Or we were talking about games earlier, right? When you play certain kinds of games, once you've really won the game and you're the big guy on, you know, like when you play Risk, for example, once you control most of the board, it's not a very interesting game anymore, right? It's only when we have that antagonism going. He manages to do that. He also said in an interview, he was asked, which is easier to write, fantasy or science fiction? And these are really fantasy books rather than sci-fi. He says, I find fantasy easier to write. If I'm going to write science fiction, I spend a lot more time thinking up justifications. I can write fantasy without thinking as much. I like to balance things out, a certain amount of fantasy and a certain amount of science fiction. In a sense, fantasy is a freer play of the imagination. You can achieve exactly the situation you want with less groundwork, less of a need to fill in all the background. For science fiction, I would use a lot of sources to set up, for instance, what a being from another planet would be like. Now, that said, I think when we look at some of these philosophical themes, we'll see that he actually did do some groundwork, but the groundwork that he's doing is not really science stuff. It's philosophy stuff, probably, that he encountered in college. He also said about characters, I like a character that is complex. I don't like writing about people who are simple-minded or average. Any protagonist I write has to be somewhat complicated. I can see that readers might see him as a bit larger than life, but that's not my intention. My intention is to examine the psychological, emotional, and mental changes in a complicated man, a man of greatness. And you notice he says man. He doesn't have any compelling female characters. Unfortunately, that's something that he did get criticized about quite a bit, and rightly so, I think. But the idea is that he wants to see how, you know, changes play out. And he does it through sort of inner dialogue and having the characters develop over time through their relationships. He says, let me put it to you this way. The way that these Chronicles of Amber are narrated, we begin with one main character. And we begin with a thing that you see in a lot of film noir stories, right? Somebody wakes up and they don't know who they are. They're suffering from amnesia, and then they go around, and people do seem to recognize them, and they're trying to piece together who they are. And you get the idea that they must be somebody dangerous or powerful, maybe evil. And they as they acquire more and more information, they find out that they're within a whole like plot. There's a lot of stuff going on, right? And that's how he starts this out. He's in a hospital in New York. He's lost memory of who he is. He got in a car crash. I'm going to, drive through this very, very quickly. So, we can always ask questions about this. But it turns out that he's actually from the royal family of Amber. And so what's Amber? Amber is this other world, which is more real than this world. This world is just a shadow, as it turns out, of Amber, just like so many other worlds are. Sort of like, the worlds of fiction. We can manipulate them. Amber is the real world. And he is from the royal family. He's got a lot of brothers and sisters, none of whom are trustworthy at the start. He's got a father named Oberon. There's a dwarf hanging around. He's not quite clear about what's going on with this dwarf named Dworkin, who turns out to be his grandfather. And Amber is where the reality lies, and we'll talk about that theme in a bit. And the story involves these sort of plots within plots that are gradually revealed. They're all told from the point of view of this guy, Corwin. And later, in the later books, which we're not going to really talk much about, his son, Merlin, is the one who is the main character. And there's a lot of reported speech, where characters are telling stories, but you can never quite be sure if they're lying to you or making stuff up, or doing, you know, pitching things to their own advantage until all the pieces are put together in the end. Now, Corwin, like all the royal family of Amber, he's got certain advantages. He's very smart. He's very strong. He's got this amazing healing capacity. You know, he's just been in a car accident, but he's ready to leave the hospital almost immediately. And he can also do something that he finds out later on. He can, what they call, walk through shadow. And what that means is he can manipulate reality itself unless he's in Amber, which is the real world. So a world like ours, where he's spent several centuries, they're also immortal. They can only be killed, you know, like stabbing them or something like that. He's actually had the bubonic plague and recovered from it, you know, so he's pretty tough. And all of his brothers and sisters are pretty tough, too. But what happens is his memory gets restored. And as it does, he starts to realize, oh, there's a brother that I hate. And that brother is currently, you know, he's not quite the king yet. The coronation hasn't happened, but his father, Oberyn, has gone away. And the succession has gone to this guy, Eric, who he's hated since they were kids together. They actually are brothers. There's, all these kids are either brothers and sisters or half-brothers and sisters. And so he ends up teaming up with another brother who's on the outs to try to overthrow him. And it doesn't go very well. As a matter of fact, the other brother is able to get away. But Corwin is captured. And Eric burns his eyes out and casts him in a dungeon. And that's close to where the first book ends. Because as it turns out, with that amazing healing capacity, even eyeballs can come back. And so eventually he does come back. He manages to escape through what are called trumps, and we'll talk a little bit more about them in a moment. And then, you know, the story just continues from there, and it weaves in all these other themes. It turns out there's this dark road on which fearsome creatures are coming through and attacking Amber. Corwin is concerned with that, but he's also interested in raising a new army to try to attack. He figures out, turns out gunpowder doesn't ignite in Amber. It does ignite in our world, but not out there. And so everything is done, you know, more or less arrows and sticking people. But he finds out that jeweler's rouge will actually ignite, like gunpowder in Amber. So he has this time in the second book where he's, you know, working with arms dealers on Earth and getting all this jeweler's rouge and getting bullets essentially filled with them instead of gunpowder. They all think he's nuts. And then he raises an army and goes into Amber just in time to find the forces of evil attacking. And he turns the tide, and his brother Eric dies a very noble death. And now, you know, things sort of proceed from there. And what you notice is, at first, Eric is the enemy. And then it turns out that these other forces turn out to be the real enemy. And there's plots going on. One of his brothers was bringing in the real enemy, which is coming from Chaos. And turns out that Chaos wants to destroy Amber completely. And I'm not going to go through all the twists and turns, because that would take us all night. But it's interesting to see how Zelazny is able to pull this off on what we could call a metaphysically epic scale. So this leads into these philosophical themes. The first one I want to talk about, and I made a handout for you that might help with this, is this notion of Amber as being the real world. So over and over again in the story, there's all these discussions of Amber as the reality and places like our world as being what they call shadows. So the reality is the world that truly exists. We exist, but we're not as real. And what that means is that this world is, to a certain extent, kind of imaginary. It's not really all there. And so these people who are of the royal family, they can manipulate shadows to make them do what they want. So if they want to change this world slightly so that you're wearing a white shirt instead of a black shirt, they imagine it, and a little shift like that doesn't take too much. Or they can travel along and move from shadow to shadow. They can even, like, take over a world and make it into their world. They rework it. So one of his brothers, Random, loves to gamble and drink and play music. So he just creates a shadow in which he can do that you know, for decades, and then that's what he does. So we have an existence or a reality that's most real, and the others are imitations or copies. They're distorted. They can be manipulated. What this looks like philosophically is something that goes all the way back to Plato. So Plato had proposed that there were really two worlds. There's the world that we see, the visible world. He talks about this in the Republic and a few other dialogues as well. You know, the world of material things. So there's books like this, right? And this is a book, and this is another book, right? These are different from each other. Neither one of these are what book itself is. There's some other world in which the archetype or original of book exists. And that book doesn't necessarily have any given number of pages. And, you know, it's probably neither green nor white, but the essence of book exists out there in some more real world, the world of what he called the forms or the ideas. Now, later interpreters of Plato expanded this idea more and more. And eventually, people that we call Neoplatonists, they had a lot of different ideas. But some of them had the idea that there was what we could call a whole bunch of shadow worlds. They didn't use the term shadow, that's Zelazny. But a whole bunch of worlds that were not really real. They're just reflections of the true world that we're all, in some way, hankering to get back to. And we are, you know, the selves that we have here, they're not really that real either. There may be a part of us that's, you know, connected with that real world. Maybe some of us are actually not even real characters at all. We're just sort of like bit players that don't even realize that they're just, you know, stock footage or something like that, right? Poor bastards, they don't know what's going on. And so this idea is pretty old. And it's not just in Plato. You see reflections of this in certain Indian philosophies, in certain Chinese philosophies. This is an idea that a lot of people have played around with. And Zelazny is using it for Amber. As it's going to turn out, what really makes the essence of that world is this thing called the pattern. And all of these royal people of Amber have to walk the pattern, which is kind of like a labyrinth. And once you step on it, you're stuck. If you don't complete it, it kills you. It destroys you in a horrible way. It's very painful, I guess. And there's a few scenes where things like that are hinted at about to happen to somebody. And when they walk this pattern, that gives them the power over shadow. There's this pattern is sort of like the archetype for the world. And by having that pattern there, it gives them power over shadow. It also, the pattern is part of who they are. It's woven into these cards that are called trumps that they can use to contact each other or to pull each other through, you know, from one place to another, to communicate with each other, to attack each other. One guy stabs another one through the cards. And so there's this very interesting, you know, kind of mysterious interplay between all these things. They're all connected with each other. As it turns out, later on, we find out that the pattern itself, the pattern that they're working with, is not the original pattern. There is a yet more real world with a more original pattern, and that is where all this power comes from. So when Amber is real and all these other shadows are generated out of it, it's because of the power of the pattern and then something else going on. And the something else isn't completely filled in. It gets more complicated because there's also imitations of the pattern itself in other places that you can walk and maybe gain some power that way. Now, what would be the opposite of the pattern? It's chaos. And so you've got Amber, which is this place where things stay the same. You've got Shadow, which can be manipulated by these people, and where things can go kind of wonky from time to time. Like, you know, you get there and you think that it's going to be, you know, an Arthurian realm, and it turns out there's, you know, diabolical creatures emerging from some fairy circle attacking everybody, and now you've got to get involved. You can't predict all these things. Now, if you keep pushing the shadow further and further and further, he says you reach a point where the shadows start to go crazy and you can't control them anymore. That's the courts of chaos. And as we find out about the third book or so, chaos preceded amber. So amber is, you might say, order, and chaos, which is where all these terrible creatures, the Black Road, all this stuff is coming from, chaos is more original. And amber was created by some people coming from chaos. And so we've almost got like a bipolar thing, order and chaos fighting each other. This is a common theme. You know, it's not just Zelazny who's playing with this. We'll see other people like Moorcock playing with this as well. But the people in chaos, they want to destroy the pattern and you know, bring things back to the original chaos. And what would that mean for us poor suckers here in this world? That would mean this world would disappear. It would be like churned up. All the worlds would disappear. If amber goes, all of us shadow places go. And so we're in the middle of this cosmic struggle as it gets... We only find out this by about the third book. And then the rest of it is sort of fighting against that. There's a remedy for this. And by the end of the fifth book, Corwin will take this jewel, which was used to create the original pattern. His brother Brand was collaborating with Chaos. He wanted to destroy the original pattern and then create a new pattern. To you know, be like his own private world. He wanted, essentially, it's a narcissistic dream of taking over everything. Corwin is worried about the original pattern being destroyed. His father, Oberyn, shows back up and is going to try to fix it. And if he doesn't fix it, that means that chaos will rule and destroy all of the worlds, including the Earth that he's come to love so much. And he decides to create a new pattern. And it takes everything out of him to do that. But he does manage to create it. Turns out the original one's still there. And then there's a lot of query, well, what's going to happen now that we've got like two patterns? Are they going to wipe each other out? They end up establishing a new kind of equilibrium. But you've got, these are pretty, you know, high-level metaphysical themes that we're talking about there. The real world, what is our world like? So this is a good place to sort of take a pause. I've thrown a lot of stuff at you. Any questions about, you know, what we've talked about so far? Because we've got some other things working off of this chaos and order as well. Or comments, or what makes you think of something? Or...
Well, I was just going to say I read the first two books, but I didn't get to the last three, so I just want to know how it ends. I just want to know how it ends. That's all. No, I know you've found the writing. I had trouble with the writing. I just did. Maybe it's a classical education in reading all that literature, but really.
Well, he's been criticized by some people as like, you know, trying to throw everything but the kitchen sink in there. You know, some people think he's a little too clever. And there is one book, and I don't remember which one, but it's considered to be kind of a failure because, like, all of those tendencies come together, you know.
He's fighting, he's doing all this business, and it sounds like he's very in this, you know, fantasy, medieval thing. Then he stops and he has a cigarette. Well.
Yeah.
You know, and again, it's my issue. It's my issue. I have been called a writing snob, but I mean, it's my issue.
Yeah.
And but it sometimes it's just, you know, it was very creative, and I said I'm going to give up the laws. I'm going to get beyond the lousy writing to go to the creativity, which you know. But I'm working on this other book that's like 1,200 pages, so I had to get back to that. But I did want to know how it ended.
Okay. Well, you know, there's two things to say about the cigarette thing. So one, when I started doing research on this, I found out that, and I didn't notice this when I was young. Because everyone smoked, you know, back then. Zelazny was an avid smoker himself, and most of his characters smoke until Zelazny quit smoking, and then after that point, none of his characters smoke anymore. Well, so a bit of it's probably like projection of himself.
Well, I mean, it just seems weird to be like if you're watching an episode of Game of Thrones, and then
right.
They'd stop and have a cigarette, you know,
yeah.
And say, what? You
yeah,
know?
So there's the anachronism thing, right? So... If you think about the way in which amber is related to these shadow worlds and to our world, right? our history is just one of many possible histories. And in it, like, tobacco could have been discovered earlier. So here's an example of what he does in manipulating Shadow. He needs some money. So he finds a South Africa where nobody actually mined the diamonds, and they're just sort of, like, sitting there. He picks them up and then gets himself back to another Shadow world. So that's why Zelazny can have all of his characters, and this is why he can have all of his characters smoking wherever they happen to be.
Well, it seemed like he took the Shadow world of Earth and kept it. You know, I mean, he was very, very enamored, and he really loved Earth. And he really took on all the, you know, all the stuff. But then he brought that into even Amber and all these other places that he would go into. But he always brought in that energy of Earth. That's why it seemed kind of mixed up.
To go back to how it ends, when I was saying that Corwin establishes a new pattern. When you make a pattern, the original pattern was created by his grandfather, Dworkin, right, as we find out. And when you create the pattern, you're creating it in part out of the jewel, but also out of yourself. And so the new pattern, in a way, makes Earth more real. Because he, like you said, he loves Earth so much. He's become enamored of it. And so, especially Paris, too, it turns out, he, like, puts all of those experiences and memories into the new pattern, which creates an Earth that's more real, equally real to Amber, which, you know, that's like in the books afterwards, how does that pan out, you know. You're right, he really does love
it seemed
Earth.
To make him a more compassionate and person than like his brothers were, because they just seemed so... You know,
cold,
more like
and cruel.
Cold and not having any emotions at all. And,
yeah.
And Corwin really had a lot of the Earth-like emotions. And
they do have two emotions, hatred and suspicion. <laughs> 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 So, I mean, that's a really good observation. Well, let's talk about, we're going to come to actually, that's going to be one of the main themes later on, kind of immortal change. Have good luck.
Good luck with your paper.
So Amber and Chaos, one of the other things I want to talk about is... Friedrich Nietzsche, in his first main book, The Birth of Tragedy Out of the Spirit of Music, which he wrote while he was still a college professor, he talks about two primal forces or attitudes, what he calls the Dionysian, which is chaos, you know, just complete ferment, everything is changing, and then the Apollonian, which is order. And a lot of people interpret The Birth of Tragedy, especially artists, they read it just in terms of those two tendencies, the tendency towards, you know, like dynamism and creativity, but also like things falling apart, a conflict, and then order being, you know, static, but you manage to keep things. So like think about how painting works. You know, if you want to be a good painter, you do have to learn drawing generally. Why? Because you need to know the structure of things. That's Apollonian. But then the color, that's more Dionysiac. Unless you're like very, you know, meticulous about your color, like pointillism would be very Apollonian, right? These little dots, the slapdash thing would be very Dionysiac, and so you know it seems like something we could naturally read in there because we do have amber order, the pattern, chaos. There's no pattern. There turns out to be something kind of like it called the logos, but we don't find that out in these books, and. What's going on there? It seems to be a very similar metaphysical structure to what Nietzsche is setting out. And similarly, the Dionysiac for Nietzsche is prior to the Apollonian. Before you have order, you have to have this primal chaos that everything is coming out of, all the possibilities, and then order comes out as one possibility. That's almost kind of like a virus in certain respects. So, you know, viruses, they invade and they replicate and they impose their order on everything else. Order, Amber does that on the rest of the cosmos. All those shadows were originally just chaotic stuff, but Amber's there sort of like a beacon that lights everything up. No wonder the chaos people hate it and they want it to be destroyed, right? It's ruining their fun. Nietzsche talks about the Apollonian as being something like an armed camp. He says, look at Greek architecture. You know, those Doric columns, you know, there's there's a lack of movement there, but there's also sort of like a threat, you know. The Parthenon is there to project order into the world, you know. And things work best, according to Nietzsche, when these two forces can exist in a creative tension. That's what tragedy, and not all tragedy, but just the early tragedy of Aeschylus and Sophocles was able to pull off. With later tragedy, it all falls apart, and you get a different thing coming in, a third force, the Socratic, and that's, you know, for Nietzsche, that's terrible, it's no good. The third force ends up becoming dominant. But if you leave that third force out of it, you've got something very similar to what is going on there. Now, Zelazny studied Nietzsche. Zelazny studied poetry at a time when poets were also studying Nietzsche and influenced by Nietzsche. I think it's plausible that there's some of those themes kind of folded into there. Chaos is original. Oberon and his dad Dworkin, you know, take this jewel. They make a new order. They establish it. They defend it. Their children defend it. The children aren't even aware of, you know, where this order originally came from. They think it's actually more primal than the chaos. But the chaos is fundamentally more primal. And what works best in the end is a merging of the two and a kind of truce in Corwin's son, who's born from Corwin, and this woman Dara, who's descended from Amber but also from the courts of chaos. And Merlin is raised in the courts of chaos. It turns out that he's the person the books are being narrated to as well. So there's a reconciliation. And in the end, there's also a third force created when Corwin takes his memories of Earth and creates a new pattern. So I think that's a second major philosophical theme. I have another one that's kind of connected. If you want to do, should we stop for questions or comments or jump right into it? What do you think? Up to you guys. Anything burning on your tongue right now? Or?
Well, I was just checking when we talk about the separate worlds.
Yeah.
It reminded me of Tad Williams' Otherworld series.
I haven't read that. How's it?
It's a four book series, and it's a more contemporary approach to a virtual reality world.
Oh, okay.
There are diabolical people in it, you know, of course.
Yeah.
But it's a situation where children go into a virtual reality game, when you're talking about games.
Okay.
And they end up in this virtual reality world where they can die. It's a real world. And there's a whole lot that goes on over the four books about who created this world and what's happening to the children. And very, very deep.
Well, that's actually a really good segue, because if we think about it in terms of games, what makes a game interesting is that we're either discovering something or that there's consequences to it, right? That's why I think one reason why people enjoy gambling, because you can actually not just win but also lose, so it introduces a kind of excitement. And that fits in with the third philosophical theme. So Zelazny talks about what's called solipsism, and this is a term that comes out of philosophy. And it means the viewpoint that only the self, the individual self, is really existent. Everything else is just sort of figments of one's imagination. So, you know, if we talk about us all being characters in the mind of God or something like that, that would be a solipsism where God is the one thing that really exists, and all the rest of us are just kind of, you know, playing around in the divine head. Now, the reason he brings it up is because he says it's a danger for the people of Amber, the royal family, because they can manipulate shadow. So they can make whatever they want. And there's a few passages where he talks about this. Any of them can use shadow to travel, to find worlds that they want. I mentioned random creates a world where you can gamble and drink and play music all day long and stuff like that. There's actually a scene in The Sign of the Unicorn, which is the third book. This guy, Bill, who's his neighbor on Earth, Bill says to him, "I have a peculiar feeling I may never see you again. This is to Corwin. It's as if I were one of those minor characters in a melodrama who gets shuffled on stage without ever learning how things turn out. And that could be where we are if there's these super powerful beings that are really controlling everything. He has this interesting example with a guy who seems to be, at first, just a non-Amberite Ganlian, who's actually going to turn out to be his dad in disguise. But Ganlian says, here we go. He's talking about, here we go. Ganlian could ask me anything he wanted. It also went without saying I would listen to any advice he had to give to me. This was partly because his position was unique. We were not related. He was no Amberite. The struggles and problems of Amber were his only by choice. We'd been friends and then enemies long ago, finally again and friends again and allies. And so he says, it's friendship alone that bound us, a stronger thing than bygone debts and points of honor. In other words, the thing which gave him the right to bug me on matters like this. It's what allows him to sort of intervene into the world of this weird family who are the most real people. Again, it turns out that Ganlian is actually the father, so, you know.
Well, that's interesting.
Yeah.
So this is...
Oh, I'm giving stuff away.
No, I'm not going to read it. I just want to... I mean, so, you know,
yeah.
Looking for Avalon and with him. And like you said, they were these friend, you know, frenemies and that ended up being Oberon.
Well, the original Ganlian dies, right? And Oberon takes his form.
Oh, okay.
So he can observe Corwin.
Okay.
And he gives him good advice here and there. They get to be really good friends. He doesn't realize that he's bonding with his dad, who he never really got to spend any time with. You know, it's sort of the opposite of a coming-of-age story. In coming-of-age story, like, the character develops, you know, and usually the parents kind of stay static. In this, the dad actually develops through being somebody else, you know. So.
Oh, no, I mean, I don't intend to read the last three books, but I did kind of want to know what happened. That's
yeah.
All.
So, well, Ganlian, well, his dad is going to die, actually, by the end of it. He's going to try to repair the pattern, and he doesn't succeed. He leaves behind all these kids. Corwin, by the way, too, is not going to become the king. Random, the screw-up younger kid,
really?
He becomes the king.
Okay, wouldn't have thought that one.
Yeah, there's a lot of surprises. Now, so to go back to this thing about solipsism, so he has sort of he has a few passages where he's thinking about this as he's going through Shadow trying to get to Cass, he says. It may be argued, and in fact has by most of us, we create the shadows we visit out of the stuff of our own psyches. We alone truly exist. The shadows we traverse are but projections of our own desires. This is what solipsism would be. Whatever the merits of this argument, it does go far towards explaining much of the family's attitude towards people, places, and things outside of Amber. Namely, we are toy makers, they are playthings. Sometimes dangerously animated, to be sure, but this too is part of the game. So this goes back to that, you know, there's consequences. But they're still treating all these people, you know, they'll raise armies of 2,000, you know, men, sort of, you know, kind of weird creatures out of shadow and then fight against each other. And they don't seem particularly, except for Corwin, they don't seem particularly concerned about all these guys who are dying for them. You know, they run out of them, let's go back and get some more, you know, from Shadow. And it makes sense that you would have that sort of view if you think that this stuff isn't really...
It's a game.
Yeah, exactly. And so we could think of this as kind of a collective solipsism, where it's only the people from Amber who really exist. Now, one constraint on this is chaos. Because he says at the end of chaos, where Shadow and chaos meet, the shadows become uncontrollable. It can't just be what you are desiring. There's something else, an other, that's pushing back. Another constraint would be the other antagonistic members of one's own family who have different desires than you. He has a really interesting conversation with Random's wife, Vial, this blind woman who he's forced to marry, because Random's really been a screw-up. He actually, there's this undersea kingdom. This is kind of a digression, but so there's an undersea kingdom called Rebra, right? And Random gets the princess pregnant, you know, without, of course, marrying her, takes off. You know, it's a big scandal. So when he's back there, they imprison him, and they say, you know, you're going to marry this other woman, and you're going to marry a blind woman, because we're not even going to, like, give you a bride who'd be, you know, all there. You're gonna deal with somebody who nobody else wants to marry. As it turns out, he and she fall in love. And this is one of the mellowing influences on his character that gives him some responsibility and all that. But she's a very perceptive person. And she says to Corwin, when he shows up, here we go, she's talking about why can't you guys, like, you can create shadows. Why don't you just each create your own little world and leave each other the hell alone? And so he says, well, we could do this. And it wouldn't work. It's because a place could be found which seemed to be the same as amber, but that would be all. We are a part of this amber as surely as it is a part of us. Any shadow of amber would have to be populated with shadows of ourselves to be worthwhile. We could even accept the shadow of our own person should we choose to move into a ready realm. However, the shadow folk would not be exactly like the other people here. The shadow is never precisely like that which casts it. The little differences add up. They're actually worse than major ones. It would amount to entering a nation of strangers. So they can't retreat into, like, a complete narcissism or solipsism, and each of them have their own little play place, in part because they're all stuck with each other as a family. Most of them hate each other. Yeah, some of them do love each other. Some of them are actually decent guys. Like, there's this one guy, Gerard, who's, you know, honorable, a little dumb, but, you know, very nice to everybody, and who sticks up for things. There's also Benedict, who could take over the whole place if he wanted to, but he prefers to be the master of arms. He's very responsible. But most of them are, quite frankly, screw-ups, you know, when it comes to, like, how to manage family. So they can't escape that. But that keeps them from falling into a complete solipsism. He also has an interesting discussion later on in the book, The Courts of Chaos. So this is the last book. And he says, here we go. He's talking about riding into shadow. And he starts talking in terms of, like, Freudian psychology. He gets pretty erudite as well with this. And he's... He says that you reach a point, here we go, there is a place where there comes an end to self, a place where solipsism is no longer the plausible answer to the locales we visit, the things we find. The existence of this place, these things, says that here at least there is a difference, and if here, perhaps it runs back through our shadows too, informing them with the not-self, moving our egos back to a smaller stage. And that's a really important point of development for any human being, any functional human being's life, to see that there's this whole world out there that is not dependent on your desires or enthralled by your desires, and not just valued by what value you give to it. Some people never really reach that point, you know. Those are usually pretty dangerous or pathetic people, depending on how it plays out. Not somebody you would want to actually be like a business partner with, or have to work under, or something like that. This is something that would be tougher for them than it is for us. Most of us learned pretty early on that we weren't the center of the world, I think, right? I know I did. I think some of us may have had that point drilled home to us quite a lot. These guys, they can change the world. So it's a lot harder for them to arrive at that point. But doing that is very important, because otherwise you can't have the sort of emotional development that you see Corwin having already in the first book, right? So that's actually the fourth theme that I wanted to talk about. And this is one that I don't have a lot of notes on, but it's sort of an open theme. Corwin is probably the character who develops the most, who exhibits the most non-negative emotions of hatred, anger, suspicion, fear towards his relatives. You can tell something's changed already at the start, because there's two incidents really early on. There's a guy who insults Corwin, and his brother Random is going to kill him, and Corwin keeps Random from killing him, and Random's like, what the hell's wrong with you? That guy insulted you. And he's like, and then Corwin, of course, says, hey, he was mine to kill, not yours, and Random, oh, that makes sense, yeah, okay, that's fine, although he tucks it in the back of his head. And then he meets with another brother who he really doesn't like, and his other brother is kind of a repellent character, Julian, who wants to kill Corwin. Corwin gets the drop on him, doesn't kill him, tells him, remember who it was that granted you your life. This is not something that any of them would have done before that. They'd gotten themselves into a dynamic where whenever they got into conflict, the conflict had to go all the way, you know. So Corwin is deeply changed from his time on Earth, you know, which affects him. He finds value in other people. He doesn't see the what we could call the shadow people as just up for doing whatever he wants to with them. After a while, he falls in love with one of them. Some other characters change. Random changes a lot. His change is essentially becoming mature and no longer the screw-up of the family. He's like the youngest kid. You know, often youngest kids are a little bit more that way, right? Eric, his arch rival, changes too. It's responsibility that changes him. So he turns out, as we find out later, again, in the fifth book, Eric blinded him, but did so precisely so that the bigger forces wouldn't get to Corwin. So he could sort of put him out of commission. He did still hate his brother. No bones about that. But he didn't hate him the way that it seemed like he did. And he stepped up and became somebody who was willing to sacrifice his life for the good of the kingdom. And the good of the kingdom means the good of the entire cosmos, right? Because he's fighting against chaos. Brand, the character who was inviting chaos in, character who changes for the worst. So what's really interesting about this is the question, here's the fourth theme. Can immortals actually change or not? What would it take to change them? Because if they can change, it'd be changing all the time because they've got, you know, forever to do it, right? So they wouldn't have any sort of fixed character. If they do have a fixed character, then you set up kind of a feedback loop where they're doing the same thing over and over again. You think our habits are hard to break once we've got them set and our family dynamics? Imagine living a millennium with a brother that you can't stand, you know? How would you ever get a reconciliation? You know, imagine being the therapist who had to deal with these people. You know? How would you break in? Well, they do, and it's not for none. There isn't any of them who say, I decided that I wanted to become a better person, so I sought out this guru, and he told me I needed to let go of my past. None of them change that way. It's through being exposed to certain experiences, seeing the vulnerability of others, having to take on responsibilities that they didn't originally want, that changed them for the better. So there's a kind of passivity to it, interestingly enough. So for all the power that these guys have. Yeah, go ahead.
I was just going to say, you know, it just kind of reminds me of the Olympian gods, because they were almost sort of godlike.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
Then all of a sudden there's a little immersion of humanity in there.
Yeah.
Like with Corwin, he got that humanity, and then that's what sort of kept, you know, kind of inserting itself in some of, in like these experiences, whether it was
yeah.
not killing the man or not killing Juliet, or these little bit of things. And it was almost when the gods started to interact with the humans, if you want to go back to the Greek, you know,
yeah.
the Greek god kind of things, and where... That's what, when you're talking about that, that's kind of the image I had in my head, because they did seem very godlike, and they
yeah.
which is why they were so dispassionate and all these sort of things, because, and why all these, they could get all these hordes of creatures to, because they worshiped them, and they would do anything for them.
Yeah.
And being, if you're around for a couple thousand years ruling the universe, you are going to have a little bit of a god complex, and they were immortal, so they have those tendencies. But there was humanity interjected in there at some point.
Yeah, and you know, it's interesting. So when the philosophers in Greece would think about the gods, one tendency that they had was to say, like Epicurus said this, the gods don't have anything to do with human affairs, because the gods are actually happy. If they got messed up with us stupid humans, they'd be all worried about what's going to happen and upset with, you know, this person for not getting things right. So they just leave everything totally alone. And the Stoics said, no, the gods, you know, they're involved in the whole cosmos. They care about us as, some of them thought they cared about us as individuals. They're still, you know, totally blessed, but, you know, somehow they were never really able to explain how all those came.
Well, I mean, they came in different forms and
yeah.
interacted and interbred and stuff. I mean, but they were interacting with humans.
Yeah.
And then the demigods that came from that, you know, all kind of things.
Well, yeah. Most of the demigods didn't turn out too well, you know. you look at, so Hercules was like a major figure, right?
Yeah.
He has a terrible end, right? Theseus, he doesn't have a good end. Who
Icarus.
Else?
Icarus?
Yeah, well, Icarus is from Daedalus,
Icarus.
Right?
Yeah.
Well, he's a terrible end, too.
Yeah.
The
Minotaur?
Well, the Minotaur, the bull is sent by Poseidon, and then the queen and the bull have the Minotaur as a child, so I guess you could say it's semi-divine. He doesn't have much of a chance to start with, right? He's a Minotaur.
And Theseus took care of that.
Yeah.
Perseus.
Yeah. You know, the only Greek hero who has a really good end, I would say, is Odysseus. And Odysseus also dies in battle. And this is a total digression, but because it has nothing to do with Zelazny, but it's an interesting thing. So Odysseus has two sons, according to these legends. One is from Penelope, Telemachus, right? The one who's waiting for him to get home, who has to grow up without a dad and all that. The other one is from Circe, that witch who turned all of his sailors into pigs. Yeah. And I forget what his name was. But anyway, when he grows up, he takes a ship to Ithaca to try to find his dad. And there's a fog at night. And so, you know, these people are landing. Nobody knows who they are. Odysseus comes out, and he's kind of an old guy by this time, but he can still wield a spear, and he comes out, and his son runs him through. And so then he dies, but here's the sort of happy ending of it, sort of a happy ending. Telemachus marries Circe, the other son marries Penelope. And said, well, wow, the Greeks were really into incest, right? But it's not. Here's the thing, if you plot it out,
yeah,
there's no bloodlines crossing. It's like sort of typical Odysseus, you know. You find some way to everything to work out in the end.
A little age discrepancy, but not anything.
Yeah,
else.
I mean, that doesn't make much sense. It's not like they could have had kids anymore, but you know, so nobody quite knows what to make of that. But it's one of the. I mean, Jason, who's kind of a putz, dies sitting under the Argos. The thing on the front falls on his head and kills him.
The figurehead.
Yeah, exactly. There's all sorts of bad ends. So the demigods don't do so hot. The gods themselves, they don't seem to be that happy, the Greek gods. But with the way the poets depict them, right? They're getting, like, Zeus is always trying to sneak around on Hera. He's the king of the gods. I mean, he controls everything, and yet he's got to watch out for this wife because he can't control his urges to make all sorts of little demigods.
Well, you run into that with Norse gods, Roman gods.
Oh, true, yeah, yeah.
Well, the Titans, too. I mean,
the primary operating factor tends to be manipulating humans.
Yeah.
To do their, you know, whether it's sex or something else. There's a lot of manipulation of humans without caring about what really happens to humans.
Yeah, that's true.
In the legends, in the myths.
Well, that was true to some point, not at that extent, but with these Amberites, with these other people from the shadows that they kind of used for their own ends, too, without a lot of care and concern.
Yeah, and, you know, I mean, there's people who live in Amber who aren't of the royal blood, but they're sort of like, you know, grandfathered in or something, right? They matter. And then the sort of shadow kingdoms that are really close to Amber, they matter more than the ones that are more distant. And, you know, in these books, we don't actually know very much at all about what the Chaos people think. That'll happen later on in the new series that he brings out afterwards, where Merlin Corwin's son is the main character. But you know, we have we have a brief encounter where Corwin kills one of them. There's this Dara character who's kind of a half breed, and that's about it. You know, so he leaves a lot of. He's smart. You don't want to actually reveal everything. I think it's a pretty smart thing. But this notion of an immortal changing, that's what, to sort of bring this to a culmination, that's what allows Corwin to create the new pattern. His brother Brand wanted to do so, but that would have been just a reflection of his own desires. It would have been terrible for everybody. First he was going to like destroy the whole worlds to do so, and then he's going to create another world in his own image. Corwin doesn't create it in his own image in the sense of like creating it just to satisfy his own desires. He creates a world in which Paris would be real, and all the people that he met would be real. So he's kind of, in a way, it's godlike, right? He's granting them reality, the reality that he has, almost as a reward, just a reward for being Earth. So.
And he was developing like the ability to fall in love because he was
Dara. Yeah, yeah.
I mean, he had sex with Dara, but then he said, "Oh my God, I actually felt something for her." You know, it's
yeah.
like, "Whoa, what was that?" You know, it wasn't just a physical.
Well,
thing.
Before that, there was Lorraine too. Right?
Oh yeah, Lorraine. Right.
And
he felt for her.
Yeah.
To some extent.
So you know, they have to learn, I guess, through suffering, and suffering is one of those things where you it can make you a better person. But there's nothing automatic about it. Suffering can make you a much worse person if you're just consumed with the wish to, attain vengeance, right? Or it makes you paranoid of everybody, you know? But the suffering that Corwin goes through, and Random, makes them better people.
Or the Buddhist tradition where suffering leads to transcendence. It's
yeah.
All of Buddha is all of the first is all the suffering.
Well, you know,
you learn from suffering and then you transcend suffering.
That's a good point. So Zelazny, he doesn't just work in Arthurian and Celtic and Greek and whatever you want.
Mm-hmm.
He plumbs everybody's mythologies and cultural systems. Not so much in the amber stuff, but like Lord of Light he's drawing heavily on Buddhist and Hindu themes, I think he was able to do that in part because he goes to college and then he like studies comparative mythology and finds ways to weave all that stuff in. I think it's probably harder to do that with the same kind of freedom that he did in the 60s and 70s today because there's a lot more people who'd be like calling you and everything. But yeah.
Well, creativity comes out of chaos, and that's what keeps every time chaos breaks open, it needs more opportunity for something else to develop. So it's not always a bad thing, It's what brings the creative force into existence.
Yeah, so that was with the Nietzsche thing. I think that's why artists were so enamored of that book, The Birth of Tragedy, because you've got that duality between order, which you do have to have as an artist, right? Because if all you have is chaos, you never get anything done, right? But that, that ferment, that drive that always floods over the structure of order. If we don't have that, it gets really stale. Yeah. So, we should probably. We have time for more discussion.
So this universe was based on chaos,
exploded
into this realm.
Oh, our universe
that
we live in, yeah.
So, if you take all of, if you want to go back to the initial part of our existence, it came from chaos.
Yeah, and you look at the way life, just bloom of all sorts of different kinds of species. I forget. So we talked about Asimov a couple sessions back, and in the Foundation trilogy, it turns out that Earth was like the only place where there was chaos in that sense, where like a whole bunch of different species. Other places, life did develop, but it was only like one or two species. Earth, for some weird reason, it was like thousands and thousands, well, millions of species.
Well, and actually, it didn't develop anywhere else. Humans took species with them.
I think there were a few places where it did develop, but they said it was only like one thing that developed.
Yeah, I just reread.
This is like the fourth book, right?
Yeah, I just reread the series.
Yeah,
and they talk a lot about. Yeah, there may have been.
Because they're looking for Earth.
Yeah, they may have had a little indigenous life, but not much.
Yeah, no diversity.
No diversity. It was whatever species they chose to take with them to a specific world, and they might have genetically manipulated that species, but that was about it. And they all had their roots on Earth.
I don't know. I have to go back. I think I remember there were. They said that some life developed in other places, but it was never interesting. It was always just like one thing, like a slime mold, or
Yeah, there were planets with some indigenous life, but not much.
Yeah, exactly. There wasn't enough diversity to make it. See, the thing is, when you've got like a lot of players in there, just like with music, right? If all you do is just do this all day long. Oh, that's musical, but it is orderly. But it's pretty boring after a while. So, yeah.
Well, when you get to the end of the series, the Foundation series with Asimov, you find out that everything was being manipulated by an overmind.
That's right, yeah.
On the moon. It's really a robot.
One of the robots, yeah.
One of those AI people.
It was really a derivation of a robot.
Yeah.
That is actually manipulating what's going on in the Foundation world.
Yeah. I didn't find the fifth book, and again, there's a total digression because we're not talking about Zelazny now at this point. I didn't find the fifth book as interesting or compelling as the first four. I don't know. Maybe I should go back to it and check it out again. It was about 10 years ago that I read the fifth book. But that could just be me, too.
Well, some of the series, and I think this happens in the Amber series, seems to always be one book where the author is wrapping up loose ends.
Yeah.
And I think that's what happens in the fifth book, The Foundation. He's wrapping up all the loose ends and explaining why all this stuff happened and coming up with Gaia and Solaria and New Earth. And it's pulling all the threads together.
Yeah, you know, he doesn't do that in these. He does do that to some extent in the next five.
In the chaos, yeah.
Yeah.
The last ones.
Which I didn't find that, those five Amber books as interesting or as good as these original five myself.
One of the things that strikes me as we're talking about this is the Amber books are, depending on where you look, frequently listed as high fantasy.
That makes sense.
As opposed to science fiction.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if I have friends who will not read science fiction or fantasy because they can't suspend disbelief enough.
That's sad.
They can't suspend disbelief. But I'm wondering if when you move from hard science fiction, which I sometimes call cowboys in space, to the high fantasy end, to get to the high fantasy end, you have to suspend disbelief more.
Well, you're in the realm of imagination.
It's far more imagination. It's far less reality.
There's less explanation.
There's less explanation. Yeah. There's less connection to real science, to real world issues. And that may make the writing. You were talking about the writing.
Well, no, it wasn't. It just was me. I had a problem with the writing, that's all.
Well, it becomes more anachronistic.
Yeah, and there are some. I mean, sometimes he will spin a metaphor.
It's simplistic.
Yeah, there's a few places where you're like, well, especially when he goes through like the shadow rides. I actually have to skip ahead through some of those myself. I tried to make myself read them. Like all the way through, because I was like, I'm sure there's some imagery in here that I'm like missing out on. Because,
Did you ever read any Patrick Rothfuss? He's only got two books out.
No.
In the Name of the Wind. He's a local author.
Oh, really?
OMG.
From like
it's fantasy, but he's like one of the outlying areas in the western part of the state.
Okay.
Rothfuss. I mean, anybody who's written two books and people are basically. beating down his door for a third, but he everything is so intricate, down to the money, down to, every language.
Oh, so he's a world builder. Right?
He's a world builder,
okay.
And it's about this young man who wants to go to a university for magicians, but it's not
okay.
Like, you know, Harry Potter magic. It's all this scientific stuff
yeah.
to be, and then he goes in these worlds, and the writing is just out of this world, and it's just so.
How do you spell his name?
Rothfuss. Rothfuss. Patrick is
okay.
The first name. The Name of the Wind is the first book, and the second book I can't recall, but those were probably the best fantasy books I've read.
Yeah.
They were so, and it's not just me, because I've heard him interviewed on public radio a couple of times, and people are just jumping all over this guy. I don't know if anybody's behavior read him in.
That'd be interesting. I mean, people get
it's about
after
5 years
it.
Ago that he wrote these books, and
yeah.
then he wrote a third book just recently about this character, Ariel, but it's not part
it's not
of
in the series?
It's not part of the series. But he left that character just hanging there on death's door. And his faith, I shouldn't say that, because I don't want to say what it was, but
yeah.
I mean, it was just, it's so good. It's
well,
just
you know,
really good.
George R. R. Martin has been keeping fans waiting now, six years?
For the last book? Yeah.
Well, for the sixth. It's not even supposed to be the last. It's supposed to be seven, right? And people.
That's a tale of spin.
The sixth is out.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, Dance of Dragons. Is the seventh?
Is it? Is it really out?
The seventh we're waiting for now.
Oh
no! I thought
Dance of Dragons. Was
there's chapter. There have been chapters released. I didn't know that the whole thing was out.
Yeah, I was thinking of
check
it
up there
because I've got all of the ones
yeah.
written.
that would be a big deal.
Yeah.
Winds of Winter is what's supposed to be next.
That's the next one.
And
well, Dance of the Dragons fifth, right then, right?
It's supposed to be Winds of Winter and then Dream of Spring.
Yeah.
So the first three. Yeah, I mean, the first
yeah.
day were.
But my point was, he's drawn immense, hatred from fans who are like, you have to give us our books, you know? And he's like, I'm the author. I write when I want to write.
Well, you get so involved with the lives of characters, it's just, you know, to the point where.
Yeah.
You know,
you know, so, I mean, in a way, to bring this back to Zelazny, so that's kind of what Corwin is doing, right? He's getting involved with these people who are really should just be kind of, walk-ons, you know, just people showing up, and they're not really major characters, but he treats them as if they are after a while.
Well, even when he goes back to Earth, you know, one thing, even he goes back to his old home, and there was
yeah.
a scene in there where, you know, the guy, and I'm thinking, you know, it just, I don't know, he just... developing humanity, just human characteristics.
Yeah.
It says here, on June 30th, 2016, a fan asked on Martin's blog if he had
uh-huh.
any special announcements for Mid-America Con in the middle of August, and he said, oh, please, just stop with that nonsense. So, yeah, neither of the last two, neither six nor seven are out, but he's been releasing
chapters. Yeah.
Yeah, but...
Yeah, everyone's worried that he might die before he does it, because he's, you know, not in the best health. It would be a shame. Imagine that sort of entanglement that would involve. You know, maybe that would dissuade some people from writing great literature. The fact that fans then will start hounding you.
Well, that's what happened with Asimov's Foundation. He didn't want to write.
You're right.
Books.
Yeah.
He didn't want to write the fourth book.
Yeah, and there was somebody.
And the fans
there was somebody else too.
Right,
but
the same thing happened
yeah.
to Sherlock Holmes with the Sherlock
Holmes.
Yeah,
yeah.
Oh yeah, he had to be resurrected too.
He had to be resurrected. And Conan Doyle did not want to continue writing him.
No.
Yeah.
He had to bring him back from the
and
dead.
The fans, were all over him.
That was one of the best moments where it's like, I don't want to, but I have to, just because you all love him so much.
Yeah. Van Vogt too with the Null A, the third book in that series. It was written in the '80s, you know, and he did that because people were still pestering him about that.
I
guess it must be a common problem.
I said that's probably happened with all the authors that have series like that. And McCaffrey with the Pern series. And
oh yeah.
Well, even the Harry Potter series.
The Harry Potter series.
If people got out, get on her.
Right. They parties. You know,
she finally
booked the last book. Yeah. Andre Norton with the Witch World books.
Yeah.
all of them, at some point, I think, got fan pressure to do another
one. It must be much easier to do now with the internet, right? Because you can just email them, and you can find out
go to their page.
Yeah, you find out where they're going to be, you know, and show up at their hotel room. And,
think of that terrible
logs.
Film. I mean, this is way off topic.
Stock.
That Stephen King film.
Oh, Misery?
Misery.
Well,
the reason she held him
ago,
hostage
too.
Was because he killed off the character
yeah.
and he had her do something that
she wanted
the Kathy Bates character thought
yeah.
was
she wanted
to write
the book.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah.
What kind of books was he writing?
I think there were
mystery?
Mysteries, right?
There were mysteries, I think.
Yeah.
Okay.
God, that was too long ago. I remember the details of that.
Well, that's pre-internet, right?
Yeah, that was such a great film. I mean, she played
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
That's kind of her.
Well, Kathy Bates doesn't
yeah.
do anything poorly.
But then, yeah, I mean, she was fantastic in that.
Yeah, she did really good with that. But well, I mean, but if you take an author like Stephen King, who doesn't serialize anything, he just cranks them out. Now, that's a totally different, you know, thing. And people aren't just hanging on bated breath for another book to come out because it's going to be kind of...
Misery is just the example of a rabid fan.
That was the thing. I was just making an
but
analogy.
You could never
between.
Predict which person would be that fan, you know? I suppose if you're a famous author, you'd go out to any, like, con where you're on a panel or something, you'd be looking out at the crowd wondering, now, who's the nut job who's going to try to, you know, buttonhole me later
Martin.
On?
One thing that's happening with Martin right now is the TV show Game of Thrones
has
diverged from the books.
Yeah.
Yes.
The storyline is...
That takes some pressure off of him, though, because you can say, well, just watch the TV
show. But it
caused
a real fan reaction.
Yeah.
Well, I heard that people like it better since they've deviated because they said it got more interesting. So I only watched like the first three seasons, and then you don't get HBO, so I can't binge on that for 2 days and you get it free. I can't watch 15 episodes of Game of Thrones and sleep for 3 weeks. I can't. It's
well,
just,
if you
it's
do
too
sleep,
much.
You're going to have some weird dreams.
Well, that's what I do. I do. I dream all that. I can't do all that violence. I just can't. And the only thing I really liked about it was it's just really good memory work to keep all those people straight,
all
those kingdoms straight. That's the only dumb reason I watched it, to keep all of that. That was my Alzheimer's prevention program.
With Martin, you almost need, like, you know, when you used to go to the baseball games and you'd have, like, the program.
Scorecards.
Yeah. You almost need something like that because he's got
well, I was doing really good. Even when I wasn't watching it, I was still remembering. My friend says, whoa, you're really good at this. I says, yeah, I work real hard to get all those people straight.
Yeah.
Well, I think all of the world builders have huge casts.
Yeah.
All the world building authors. They're not small casts. They're not small groups of people.
Yeah, and you know, with Martin, so this is one something we explored at the very beginning. There is this contrast that's made between Martin and Tolkien. Tolkien is like the guy that you're describing. He is what they call an architect, where... they plan everything out, like, you know, the way the currency works, the way the languages work, you know. And then they throw the characters in there once they've got all that structure in place. And Martin said, I'm more like a gardener. I plant these seeds, and then I water them and see what comes up. And, you know, if something comes up, then I cultivate it. But it's probably going to die, you know. And, you know, then I see what can happen with it. I don't really know where things are going. So, you know, the story could crash and burn at a certain point. Which may, in fact, be the case. Who knows? Maybe that's why he has trouble getting the stuff finished. But so there's two totally different approaches, you know. With the one, you know where everything's going because you've already got it plotted out. With the other, you know, it's probably, in some ways, it's easier because you don't have to do all that planning work.
Well, yeah, it's free form. You can just keep moving.
Yeah, but then it's sort of like improvisation with music. What if you get yourself boxed into something that you can't get yourself out of?
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Oh, there's always jazz. I can take care of that. Oh, you never can get boxed in with jazz.
That's true. Well, that's a good thing to close this on. So.